Jehovah Witnesses and Worldly Friendship. That is very rare, but it does happen, but not in my story. You know, from all the stories I've told already on my channel, it really paints a dark image for the Jehovah Witness organization. But my critique and activism against that organization is towards the organization themselves, the upper echelon, upper ups, the corporation pretty much, right down to the elders. But even elders, what I'm trying to say is, from the rank and file onto some elders, there are really good people in there with their hearts in the right place. They're just like everybody else. They have families. They want the best for their families and their friends. They want to save the world. There have been a handful of elders, I would say the majority from what I've experienced, except in the new community that we live now. And even there are some exceptional elder leader types that do take care of their flock, I guess, or, you know, tries to lead them in the right way. But, you know, the policy of the JW organization makes them into the bad guy, the henchmen of enforcement of their policies from on top. They're in between a rock and a hard place. Either they do it or they get reproved and taken away and their privileges are shot down and they're going to have to sort of go up the JW ladder all over again, taking years probably, or even not make it at all. But the majority of all JW rank and file, and some elders, like I said, are really good people. And personally, if it wasn't for the JW brain, they would be outstanding citizens. Personally, I really wouldn't have a problem making friends with Jehovah Witnesses. But there's quite a few major deterrents that prevents me from opening up and making friends with JWs. From my perspective, from what I see around me, and not from their perspective, because they have ulterior motives. They're not trying to make friends with me for the sake of making friends like normal people. They're trying to make friends with me to get an angle into my psyche so they can use that to their advantage and trying to convert me into their faith or organization. That is pretty much the bottom line of my perception of that particular scenario of trying to make friends with Jehovah Witnesses. I try not to. Personally, I am somewhat of an introvert and I have my core group of friends that I have that I could count on maybe one hand or two. I don't make it a habit to make friends, especially now that I have children and I'm a little bit older. So my core friends from when I knew a long time ago, and my kids are my friends, and my wife, they're my buddies now. I have no time for friends. So I don't make an effort to go out to make new friends. If anything, I would like to make friends with Jehovah Witnesses before I knew how evil their organization was, just because of the fact that I have children. A lot of my wife's friends, JW friends, have children. They're family. They have families. And I would love, you know, to do the family thing of going out camping, field trips, and, you know, I guess they call it associations. With my children and myself, and in that context, sure, no problem. Like I said, I really do admire the family unit mentality of the Jehovah Witness as how they sort of portray it to the rest of the world, that ideal nuclear family of JWs. So in that context, perhaps, if anything, maybe just acquaintances, not friends. Like, you know, give them a phone call and say, hey, let's go out and go bowling or something like that, just me and the guys. I don't think I'll go that route. even if they were JWs or worldly. But I learned early on in my relationship with my wife, that's a JW member, and attending one of their district conventions, the big Super Bowl 3-day get-together, they are not really keen on having worldly friends either. If anything, it was made perfectly clear that it was absolutely unacceptable for a JW person to be friends with any worldly people whatsoever, except for the purpose of converting them into their way of thinking. Plain and simple, end of story. That was made very clear, and I understood it fully. So that was strike two or three on my part to think that my way of thinking at the time, saying it's not even worth approaching these people because they will not make friends with me anyway. So I just left it for them to approach me first, and then I will reciprocate and see if anything develops then. You know, I was open-minded. I'm somewhat open-minded to any possibilities. And besides, back then, some almost two decades ago, you cannot find the time to do friendship things with you know, JWs if you are worldly and do not desire to go to their church, because the majority of their time was taken up by church activities. So it's a lot. You have more time now these days than you did back when in the late 90s. I think if I remember right, you got two meetings per week. One of those, another day of the week was for, what do you call that? Where you go to a JW's house and you have like a little Bible study there. So that's 3 days out of the week that you're, you know, at night or whatever, occupied by church activities. Then on a Saturday, you have the door knocking routine in the mornings. And then you have the afternoon off. Then Sunday, of course, was church day. So that's what? 5 days. 5 days out of the week that you have to set aside to do church activities. Not the whole day, mind you, but you know, there's still the preparation because you have to study for it. So really, back then, there really was no time. And thinking to myself, way back then, one of my first sort of critical thinking about their organization is, wow, they sure keep you guys busy. That was what first sort of one of those red flags, that they're kept really busy. So there really wasn't no time to, you know, go out socializing once in a blue moon, but not me on my own asking a JW person to go, you know, out for, you know, a game or two or something like that. I'm sure it happens, but not in my case. So I didn't bother there, and my work schedule also kept me sort of busy as well. So the time wasn't there to make friends anyway. Besides, for the most part, I really did not have anything in common with any of those JW members anyway. Religion was out, so we're not going to talk about that, and I'm not really into sports. I'm pretty boring, so there you have it. So really, the only social interactions with JWs that I've been exposed to or, you know, hung around some was when they had their get-togethers like picnics or yeah, there was a lot of picnics, a lot of parties. We actually went out into the town once. We were in our mid-20s, so we met up with other JWs in their 20s as well and hung out that way. And the two cities that we lived in at first, they were pretty liberal as far as cities. So, you know, I guess the rules were relaxed just a little bit, and their hair was down just a little bit. And with that, it didn't really set off any red flags as to, you know, the social aspect of JWs and how they interact with the rest of the world. I knew for a fact that if I met somebody new or, you know, introduced to a, you know, one of my wife's friends and their husbands or whatever, it was always going to be something relating to religion in our first conversation, like, oh, how you doing? You know, really superficial conversations. I kept it simple with the weather. You know, they'll ask me what I do for a job and this, that. you know, really superficial small talk, and I kept it as basic as possible because I knew they were going to use my words to sort of fling it around into religion again, and they were going to explain how, you know, wonderful their religion was and talk Bible verses and stuff like that. Usually, I shot it down by saying, oh, well, that's nice, but I'm not a Christian. I don't believe Jesus was the Messiah and all that. And that pretty much ended it right there. They had no foundation to work on top of that. Because if they explained something, a verse in the Bible, I would say, well, the Bible was written by man, I believe, so I'm not going to take that as the word of God. And I truly believe that then, as I do believe that now. I'm sorry if I lost a few of you, but that is my viewpoint. But I'm not as close-minded as to say that perhaps it's true. So in the beginning, you know, people didn't know that I was worldly. They assumed that I was a JW2 because I'm married to my wife. And then, you know, my wife would explain that I'm worldly or whatnot, and then they try to, you know, work religion into their conversations with me, and I shoot it down completely. Just to, you know, set the tone and pace right off the bat as far as me, because at that point I got really tired of talking religion because I wasn't interested whatsoever, especially their brand of religion. I'm not nasty about it at all. I'm really respectful. And I tell them exactly how I feel as far as what my take in it. And I leave it at that. I don't press on. And I understand their point of view, actually, where that JW brain is trying to save me from the world and Satan and all the bad things that happen when you're worldly, supposedly, according to their dogma. But, and I understand that, and I take that into account, and I just, you know, use that to my advantage. Not really use it to my advantage. I don't press the issue to make him feel uncomfortable. I don't say, you know, get away from me, you holy roller, or be nasty about it. I'm very respectful. There was this one situation where we moved to a new city. So the local JW congregation, they do a shepherding call. And I was present at the time when they showed up. And they come in, they came to see my wife and everything. And then we're new to the neighborhood and, they, you know, asking the questions and getting to know us. And they're really sizing us up, pretty much what the shepherding call is sizing us up, especially myself. Because, of course, right off the bat, they know I'm worldly. So they want to see what sort of person I am. I believe in freedom of religion. And at the time, you know, the JWs as horrible of a dogma I thought they were, not to the extent that I know now. I mean, it was less of a negative aspect way back when I didn't know the full story. And, but I still was in favor of freedom of religion. And I would protect anybody's right for that, including the JWs at the time. They got the sense that I was sincere and I wasn't a controlling husband or their worldly stereotype of a person. They seemed that I was sincere, that I was in love with my wife. We got along really good. That's it. So I don't know if this guy was a ministerial servant or an elder, but we got into talking. We both worked in the same sort of field as far as employment. Somewhat different, but very similar. And we talked about that, our jobs, the neighborhood. I mean, small talk, but he got a little angling with me or kind of like built a little rapport because we worked in the same field as far as employment. So he kind of used that to kind of maybe soften me up a little bit. And I was oblivious to all this because I'm just talking to the person like I would talk to anybody else. You know, very sincere. My sort of defensive wall wasn't as fortified as it is now. Not that I would be duped into, you know, becoming a JW back then, but I had my defense mechanism to kind of shoot their dogma out of the water if they got a little bit too close or laying on the religion too hard on me. So he came in 2-3 shepherding calls later. Sometimes he would come over and visit, and we would talk a little bit. The wife is there, of course, and another person, another JW person, because they always travel in twos. In this particular time we talked about hobbies. So let me pick just a hobby, crocheting. I'm a master crocheter. I'm just throwing that out. Something obscure that not many people are really into, especially men. So I'm just picking that right out of the blue just to, as a simulation. I told him I was into crocheting. I like crocheting sweaters or scarves and you know, beanies and what have you. So he was like, oh, great, that's nice. I never heard of that before. And we talked a little bit more. He's asking, you know, the usual questions, like he was interested or just making small talk. Obviously, he wasn't into it till that right off the bat. So, you know, it was a pleasant, you know, get-together. They did their little call there, and then they left. I think nothing of it. So I don't remember how much time has passed, but I would say maybe 2-3 weeks. But he comes back to do another shepherding call. At this point, I don't even know if it is a shepherding call, if it was a shepherding call or what. Now I come to realize that it was a return visit for me to count time. So all this time he was just sizing me up, setting me up for the big sale. But he was still sort of, you know, chipping away at my defenses at the time by talking small talk about something totally unrelated like crocheting sweaters. What this guy did was he brings in Awake or Watchtower magazine. I don't know, he must have dug deep and far and wide to get this particular publication, but on the cover of the publication had, for example, as a simulation of a guy sitting down crocheting a sweater on the Awake or Watchtower magazine. I forget which one, but it was, you know, the paperback, the little small magazine that they pass out, and he shows it to me. I forgot when it was published or if it was even remotely close to, you know, that time period that we were talking about this. And it was just in quick passing that I told him that I was in crocheting, you know, sweaters. And he pulls this out and instantly I knew what this guy was all about and what he was trying to pull. And it made me pretty angry. I mean, not only that he took my sort of trust or I don't even know how to describe it. He wasn't sincere. And I smelled that a mile away once he showed that publication. And he gave me the magazine and says, here, I'd like you to read this about crocheting. And, of course, it's a Watchtower magazine. And at the time, many things were going through my mind. I wasn't angry like I was going to hit him or anything, but I was like, well, look at this guy, the nerve of this guy doing this. And I was sort of jumpy and testy towards him because I remember my wife telling me that she spoke to his wife, and I guess they were talking together. This person that came over and mentioned that I was a bit standoffish and sort of, you know, I wouldn't say combative, but I was on guard. You know, the guards went up and I snapped. Verbally a little bit. But I told him, I'm not going to read this. And I told him, I remember exactly what I told him. I said, I'm not going to read that. For one thing, the subject of crocheting has too many references of the Bibles that doesn't relate to crocheting at all. I mean, it was totally, you know, unrelated to the story at all or the hobby of crocheting. If anything, it was, you know, swimming in two subjects here and there between Bible verses and the subject of crocheting. So I'm not going to get anything out of this particular conversation that I don't already know. Second of all, it was biblically, you know, inspired or the subject matter is heavily towards the religious aspect of this magazine and not the hobby of crocheting sweaters. And I told him just like that, you know, he packed up his magazine, said his goodbyes or whatever, and that was the last time he ever came back to the house. I met him in get-togethers and stuff like that. We had, you know, had little chit-chat. It wasn't like, you know, get out of my house or I'm going to, you know, cut you down or something. It wasn't like that at all. It was just a minor disagreement, a misunderstanding on his part as to how I was going to react to that predicament and sort of, you know, telepathically, I guess, on my part, giving that impression don't pull this crap on me again because I'm not going to fall for it. So from that point on, some 15 years ago, this was early in my wife's and I marriage, I had my defenses and guard up against any JW person that I first encounter. My defenses are high, and I read between the lines. I listen closely to what they're saying, then try to think of what angle they are using on me. In normal friendships, when you start up a conversation or you meet somebody, maybe you have your guard up just a little bit, but not on high alert that I have it with JW people now. That is my experience. And it has always been like that, and the usual MO, method of operandi, that the JW person tries to use on me, you know, try to befriend me, is always the same. They try to get a little angle of what makes me tick, and use that to their advantage to sell their brand of religion. And if a friendship starts off in those terms, it's really not a friendship. Though, like I said, I do understand their point of view where they're trying to save my life, basically, according to their dogma. In a way, it's so weird. It's admirable in a way. But then again, it's you know, sinister from the corporation's, you know, aspect of it. The rank and file, they have no clue that they're doing that. They're trying to save your life. They're doing a good deed, and it's going to help them, you know, going to the paradise afterwards by saving as many souls as they can. But for the organization, it's just another battery to or money-making machine for their coffers. So another story is in the community that we live in now. This time, the roles were reversed. I try to make friends. You see, I was in this get-together, you know. My wife was invited. I never get invited, which is fine. I accompany my wife once in a while. I usually try to get out of it, but she wants me to join her to, you know, to show, you know, unity between us and all that. She wants to show me off or whatever. Not make her feel too lonely. Anyway, I'm talking to a group of guys, and they're talking about again, this is just a simulation. It's another activity, but I'm going to say ice skating. They're all going to go out ice skating. That particular subject interests me. So I actually make the first sort of reaching out saying, hey, I've been wanting to learn how to ice skate for the longest. Can I join you guys when you go? And I was talking to the one guy, and as soon as I said that, this guy, I must have took him by surprise because it took him a long time to try to come up with an answer. You see, he sort of kind of looked to the side, and he made a really disturbing face, like not a thinking face, but it was a face of disgust, like he just caught a whiff of rotten eggs. He paused, and I picked up on that, you know, instantly. And I made his job easier by saying, oh, well, that's probably not a good idea because my weight on the ice is going to crack the ice and we'll all go under in the water. You know, I pretty much took myself out of that situation. And that was a huge reinforcement on my sort of distrust for the JW brain. You know, and they really don't know anything about me other than that I'm worldly. And me and my wife, we were just newly there. We're being friendly, I'm being friendly. And this new community was where we live at now. We are going to set down our roots here. We were stable. We had careers, we had a house, and this was the place that we were going to raise our children. And this guy here, yeah, he doesn't have a poker face whatsoever. And it clearly showed that particular day. And it didn't take me by surprise. It was like, oh, well, the usual deal. But in this community, they're pretty conservative, so they're a bit more strict and harder as far as the JW dogma, and they take it a bit more seriously than the liberal cities that I've lived before. So the social sort of interactions and the rumor mill and the self-imposing sort of markings that they do up here, it really shows, and they cannot hide it, really. They're not very good at hiding that fact. Sort of like modern-day, you know, discrimination in the United States. They say this discrimination is over, but deep down inside, sinisterly, it still exists, but in a more sly, underhanded, you know, below-the-radar kind of way. And that's the same sort of feeling I got with this new group of JW congregation that we live nearby that my wife goes to now. Yeah, so I don't make any effort to make any efforts to make any friends or anything like that, because it's just going to be a letdown. And now, especially now that I know a bit more of the psyche of the JW brain, it's pointless for me to even go any further. Except, you know, if they need help, of course I'm going to step in and help, you know, with whatever, whether they want my help or not, you know, depending on the situation. I can't say that JW members and worldly people do not have friendships. I cannot say that it's not impossible or it doesn't exist. Just in my experience, it's just not present. And there's no desire from either end parties to make efforts in being friends. Your mileage may vary, but I'm just laying out my experience. So my videos is directed towards other worldly people to kind of show them what to expect if they do get involved with the JW, which has been disfellowshipped and you're romantically involved with them, or if you make friends with them, what to expect. And don't judge them hardly for their behavior because of it, because they really are not in control of that particular behavior. They're just brainwashed into, you know, being that way. So don't judge the person. Just judge the organization on top, laying down these ground rules for their members as far as making friends. And of course, it's conditional. If you're not JW or part of their group, you're not anybody. That's pretty much the bottom line. You're a dead man walking. Why make friends with somebody who's going to die? It sounds really harsh and in your face, but when all is said and done, and if the JW dogma hypothetically is true, that's what's going to happen to you. You are going to die in a heinous way, and they'll be left to clean up your body afterwards.